Hi, good morning, everybody. Welcome to Connect 2015. Yesterday, we had our partner day for Connect, and we had 3.5 times as many partners registered for partner day this year as we did last year. And I think what that means is that we're all seeing this massive change in the market. There's something big happening, and we're at the center of trying to help make that happen and help drive that forward. It's just wonderful to see the growth and wonderful to see the customers that are here and people that are looking at our offerings, and then all of those partners that are here to support us and are continuing to grow the ecosystem around what we do. So thank you for being here. I'm really excited about the next couple days. I think we're going to have a lot of really good learnings. There's just so many good thought leaders here to share information. So great to have everybody here. So theme of my talk is why you should break up first. So the reason you need to break up first is because if you don't figure out how to make your enterprise composable, if you don't figure out how to make it highly agile and be able to move at much faster speeds, somebody else will. Your competitors, your direct competitors, a new entrant, there's always somebody who's going to figure out a way to do it faster in today's world. And the way we believe and the way we're seeing this all change in the market, and I'm sure that you are too, is that composability is really defining and the defining your ability to compete in the future. So there was a blog a few months ago about some companies that people were seeing completely transform and disrupt their industries. And I want to take you through a couple of those observations that folks had. So we know this one. The largest provider of hotel rooms in the world today actually doesn't own a single hotel room. Right? Airbnb now has 800,000 listings, and they don't own any of them. They didn't have to deploy any capital. How did they do that? How does Airbnb make that happen? They've built a platform. They built a platform for lodging. And what they're doing is they're taking advantage, in very, very short order, they're taking advantage of the API economy. They've built a composable company. They're composing their company by all of those people that are offering up rooms and houses. And then they're connecting to all of those amazing things on the back end, right? So they're taking advantage of Maps APIs and credit card APIs and email APIs. They're harnessing all of the power that's being provided from other companies to help them build out that company that's now disrupting the lodging industry. So Airbnb, great example of that. Another one that we all know and hear a lot about, company that has the largest fleet of taxis in the world, Uber, same thing. Uber doesn't employ any drivers. Uber doesn't own any vehicles, right? They've done just what Airbnb did, is they've built out a platform for transportation. You couldn't have done this 10, 20 years ago. It was unheard of that you could build a company that has grown that fast. They're now worth over $50 billion. They've done it in just a few years, and they've done it by creating this platform of connectivity, this integration layer to connect to iPhones in the cars and drivers and passengers, and then connect to all of those different APIs and that whole, again, that API economy on the back end. So they're connecting also to Maps APIs, Google Maps, they're connecting to GPS APIs inside the cell phones, credit card APIs. All of that connectivity they're leveraging to basically build out that company that is now disrupting and completely changing the face of transportation. They're not just disrupting the taxi industry, they're actually changing transportation, and they're starting to go into carpooling and all these other amazing areas that may actually change, you know, how we drive and how congested our cities are over time. Just by leveraging all those APIs. Another company that is maybe a little more traditional, company that is the largest phone manufacturer, Apple doesn't have any manufacturing plants. They don't build anything. But what they've been able to do by leveraging the power of all of their network of suppliers is they've been able to grow their iPhone business incredibly fast. So you think about how these businesses as platforms have been able to grow. Apple took, in Q4, Apple shipped 74 million iPhones. That was up 90% from the quarter before. Now imagine that. If you owned all your own manufacturing plants, there's no way you could scale your manufacturing up 90% in one quarter. 74 million phones they shipped. And that was because they have this platform, they're connected to all their suppliers, and they're able to scale rapidly. You look at Airbnb, you know, unlocking that capital of 800,000 listings. They've been able to unlock all that valuable inventory that really before was not going to be used. And then Uber, using that platform that they've built, they now have this ability to completely change their pricing on the fly. And a lot of us, a lot of folks, who are Uber users out there? Like three quarters of the room. Last night I got hit with their surge pricing, which we all know and hate. But you know, it's brilliant, right? Their philosophy around their surge pricing is, hey, if we have surge pricing, there will be more drivers, and that's how we deal with imbalances in supply and demand. You know, imagine a company, if your company could deal with that, could change that rapidly. They can change their pricing at the micro level, at the neighborhood level, and then when they have issues with press and things like that around their pricing, they can change it globally about how they're thinking about their pricing algorithms. They can do that because they have an underlying platform that supports everything that they do. So those are three of those, you know, really interesting modern examples of how businesses have changed. I think it's important to look back at what's happened in the past and how these versions of business models have changed over time. So version one of business, kind of V1.0 of business, was vertical integration. So if you look at, you know, this is the classic example, probably the most extreme example of vertical integration was Henry Ford. Henry Ford actually wanted to control the rubber that went into the tires that went into the Model T. So he built, he actually planted in Brazil, built rubber tree plantations. And so the idea was, you know, Ford Motor Company would have rubber trees going in one end and Model Ts coming out the back. Right, that's the most extreme example of vertical integration. But that's what we had, right? Early on, businesses really had to control everything. They had to control their supply chain. They had to manage everything that they were doing because you just didn't have this big global set of suppliers that you could work with. So that was version 1.0 of business. All right, version 2.0 comes along, and this is more along the model that I talked about with Apple, where people realize, hey, I can't do this stuff all myself. I'm going to be much better off if I am distributed, if I'm going to leverage the power of my suppliers, leverage the power of people that do it better than I do. And you'll hear companies, they used to refer to this as kind of core versus context. Focus on what the company does at the core and let everybody else who does, let the things that you do that are context, have somebody else do those for you. And if we stay with that automobile example, auto companies these days, they have other companies ship them their transmission systems and their glass, and in fact, all their electronics come often from outside their companies. Everything gets, even seating systems get provided, and they become kind of assemblers of the materials. They're marketers, designers, and assemblers, very, very similar to what Apple did and is doing. So that's kind of version 2.0. And then along comes the internet and web and e-commerce and late 90s, and we're all talking, and then it was kind of referred to a lot of, there was a magazine called Business 2.0 at the time, and it was, you know, thinking about, hey, everything's going to be changed by the web and e-commerce. And, you know, we all know that it was, right? There were dramatic changes as a result of what you were able to do with the internet, and companies now were able to connect with their customers via the web and their suppliers via the web. And the efficiency of what they did, you know, it got better. We all saw it got a lot better. But I think if you talk to most people, you know, other than companies like Amazon or eBay, most companies, people in this room, the businesses actually didn't fundamentally change. Like the core of your business, it's not like you moved from vertically integrated to horizontal or to distributed. You went from distributed to distributed using web interfaces. That was a big change. It was fundamental. It saved us tremendous amounts of money. It made companies much more efficient. But it wasn't something that was completely transformative. It was version kind of 2.1 of businesses. Okay, so I have a question for folks. If you think about kind of where we were late 90s, and where we are today. How many people in the audience feel like the state of change, disruption, flux in their business and the companies that they work with is higher than ever right now? Show of hands. Okay, that's like probably three quarters of the room. So why is that? So we had all this web, we had all these changes in web, but now people are feeling like it's changing even faster, it's going even faster. What's new? What's making it move so fast? And what's happening is we're moving to version 3, and the name we're calling it is composable. So we're in a situation now where your company, your organization is now moving to being composed of piece parts. Pieces, best you know, capabilities that you're leveraging, like the Airbnbs, like the Ubers, leveraging things from other people, whether it's other companies, other SaaS companies, whether it's developers outside your organization. You are going to be transforming into this thing, into this composable enterprise that is a whole bunch of components, and it's how you stitch all these things together that's going to make, really going to make you win or lose in the market. And a couple of examples of this is, you know, you kind of think about it. I mean, you used to build your own server farms and data centers. Now you're leveraging, you know, AWS for a lot of that. So a big part of your enterprise IT is effectively being taken over by folks like Amazon. You've got huge swaths of your company now that are being run by Salesforce, right? Salesforce is running big parts of your sales organization, your marketing groups. Workday now, those components, the data around your employees are now sitting at Workday for people that have deployed Workday. ServiceNow, you continue to see big pieces of your organization, parts of your data, things that used to be really kind of core to what you did, are now somebody else. And a really interesting example, and you look at these companies and you think of them as, you know, these are horizontal applications that people are using across every company. But there's one example here that I think is really really interesting. So Guidewire is a company that provides solutions for insurance companies for claims processing and several other functions within insurance companies. I mean, if you'd gone back 15, 20 years ago and told an insurance company, hey, we're gonna completely, you know, level the playing field across you and all your competitors by providing claims processing engine, are you interested? Most people have said, no, that's my core IP. That's what defines me as an organization. But now people realize, you know what? Guidewire's got the best solution. It's better than anything I can build. Now I need to figure out how to use that to my advantage, and how do I use it with everything else I've got internally. So we're shifting over to this composable enterprise. The shift is happening, and that's why all those hands went up in the room about these changes that we're all feeling. It's a complete shift from where we were before. And I was talking with the CIO of one of the world's largest consumer packaged goods companies last week. And she said that in her mind, she is no longer the chief information officer, that she's the chief integration officer. She thinks about her job has completely shifted. It's not about building big monolithic applications, holding on to data. It's about she didn't use the words composable, but she thinks about the job of her organization as gluing it all together. So complete mindset shift that we're seeing, and that's really, I think, tells you all about this composable enterprise. But there's one big problem that everybody in this room faces, I guess, every single day, which is, and this CIO, as well as every CIO of every bank, insurance company, tech company I've ever talked to, that's been around for more than a few years, is dealing with all of that legacy, right? So you've got these, you've got these fossils. So you've got, you know, mainframe atops, ERP Rex, Cobolodon. You've got all these really scary dinosaurs that are buried in your organization. They're under layers and layers of bedrock, and they're there. And you're trying to figure out, you know, I want to figure out how to work with those because it's core assets for my company. But how do I deal with those when I'm trying to change everything else on top, all those new exciting technologies, and I've got all these fossils buried? And the question is, what do you do? You can kind of dig it all up and blow it up and excavate it, and that's really expensive and really time consuming, and you're dusting off the bones and trying to figure out how this dinosaur lived, who put this thing together. The folks that wrote the code have been gone for a very long period of time. It's really, really, you know, trying to recreate it, it's really difficult. And you'll hear stories from CIOs of, we've talked to more than one CIO who talks about how they actually buy hardware on eBay because it's the only hardware they can find that'll work with some of their old systems. They actually have to go find, I'm seeing all these heads nodding in the room. Nobody wants to admit it. But it's happening, right? Because you have to find this stuff that works with some of these old dinosaurs. So it's a huge challenge. And what we tell people is, you know, don't excavate it. Put a tap on top of it. API-ify it. Modernize it. And then over time, you can start pulling these systems out and replacing them with something more modern. But in the meantime, you've got to modernize these things, and you've got to put APIs, modern APIs on top. And the minute you put a modern API on top of these things, you can generate tremendous value, and you actually get to learn a lot about what's underground as you're doing that. Okay, so if you do that, and you put these, and you modernize what's at the core, you can end up with this composable enterprise. You can end up with a situation where you're tapping into those legacy systems, where you're leveraging all of the power of the cloud, and you're connecting all of this stuff together. And when you need to make a change, when you need to make a change to your business, you can, because everything is coupled with these APIs. You've leveraged this API economy to make it happen. And that's where we see it going. It's just this composability will completely transform how these businesses run. We're talking today about cloud and IoT and mobility and big data and SaaS, and those are all critically important. But at the end of the day, it's that business transformation that all of these things are going to have, and we see this changing to this composable enterprise. So a couple companies that I want to talk a little bit about how they're using APIs to drive innovation. So Tesla is a perfect example. Tesla, they build beautiful cars that are really efficient. Everybody loves them. But really what they've done, the really amazing thing that they've done, is they've completely redefined how to think about kind of the car as a platform. So they've built it as a software platform. And from the ground up, they say, you know, we're going to have the ability to do updates. Safety, performance, security, updates. Just be able to do them on the fly. No other car company can do that, where they just change your car on a monthly basis. They just send another update to your car. And in fact, they have a new version of a Tesla out that's there's apparently a button you can push that puts you into insane mode. And people are pretty nervous that if you hand your keys to a valet and they get to go into insane mode, they probably will go into insane mode. So what Tesla then put out after that, they realized that maybe that wasn't a good thing. They put out valet mode. So you can put the car in valet mode and it won't accelerate super fast, it won't go very fast, so you can hand them the keys and put a password in and it's in valet mode. And I was kind of thinking to myself, you know, wouldn't it be cool if, you know, all of our cars could be updated with teen mode? For those of you who have kids, you know, I would love to have the teen mode on my cars. But, you know, you just think about how they're able to make these changes on the fly. Okay. Another interesting one. One of our customers is a fast food, one of the world's largest fast food companies, and they were building out an API on top of their menu system. And it was only to provide access for their point of sale. So they were just trying to connect their menu system to the point of sale. And fairly straightforward. It was going to leverage, help them connect things more easily. They built it out. And lo and behold, their mobile team used that same API and built out a mobile app on top of the menu system, and they deployed it. And people didn't even actually inside the company didn't really think that it was going to do much. It turned out to be this huge revenue generator where people are ordering online and picking it up inside the restaurants. They hadn't even planned that. That wasn't part of the plan. And we see that all the time, where you've got these APIs that get developed, they expose some data for a very specific purpose, and then all of a sudden somebody else over there says, oh, I could use that data for this. Well, I could use that data. If I have easy access to it, I can do some amazing things. And people can't even contemplate. I mean, when you think back to Google Maps, you know, do you think when they first built Google Maps, they were thinking that Uber would use their API to do what Uber does? I mean, I don't think anybody, I certainly didn't, wasn't that prescient. I don't know if anybody in this room was. It's just amazing to think that, you know, that's what it's being used for now, and driving an entire company like Uber just off of that Maps API. So it's happening. It's happening everywhere. It's happening in, you know, in the, some of these really forward-thinking companies, and it's happening in fast food companies all over the place. We're seeing the API economy and this composability completely change how companies are operating. So I'd like to bring up Marcus Owenby from AT&T to talk to us a little bit about how AT&T is working with APIs. Hey, Marcus. How are you?
Good. Doing good.
Good. So you're doing a lot of great stuff with APIs. I'd love to just tell us a little bit about the business that you're in for AT&T and the journey that you've been on and how you've been helping to transform that business.
Sure, not a problem. AT&T is a big company. Our main goal is to connect you and your world better than anyone else. And so our smaller part of the business is called the Partner Exchange. And we exist to make AT&T composable. It plays perfectly with what you're doing right here. We enable IT consultants and systems integrators to get access to our core capability, our assets, and wrap their own experience around that to serve their customers. So think, I'm a guy that has experience doing router sales or server sales, and I need internet connectivity. I'll take that to your local mom and pop chain of garages, and I'll connect you. And we allow these service integrators to do that with our capability.
Okay. And how did you, when you first started working on this, what existed, and then what have you built out over time using APIs? What types of infrastructure have you built out?
Well, we have our certainly a share of COBOL dinosaurs and all kinds of servers and legacy capability, and we have several different API platforms internal to us, and bringing in RESTful APIs and making that even more composable and more exposable has been proven very successful for our solution providers to turn around and make experiences with their customers.
Okay, and can you talk a little bit about kind of where it was before you did this and today, and what differences it's made to the business?
Absolutely. Think 3 years ago, if someone wanted to get a circuit from AT&T, maybe a point-to-point internet transport, they would have to call someone, and they would have to find out if service is available there, and then they would have to wait, and we would go and check. And then we would come back and give you a phone call back and say, oh yeah, you can get service here. Here's how to go about it. And 65, 70 days later, somebody would show up at your house or at your place of business and make a circuit happen. Today, through our API platform, our solution providers can, in seconds, qualify a nationwide network and get prices and cause our trucks to roll in a much more rapid time.
Okay. And what about kind of the ability to actually develop new services and kind of the speed that you can innovate? Like, has it changed the clock speed of how you've been able to build things?
It really has. Once again, we exposing this capability to not only these solution providers, but third-party developers. They're creating applications inside of our new ecosystem that's growing to do things like quote a service, right? I didn't have to go and hire a team to do that. An external developer came to me and said, hey, I can do this with your APIs. They saw our catalog and were able to work with that. So it's impressive how quickly people move using
API. Very cool. And as far as connecting, like, how many systems are we talking about that you're connecting now? And what was it like before? And how many are you able to connect today?
We are connecting hundreds, if not thousands, of systems back in, because We're a telco, and we've grown via acquisition mostly, and so we've got regional systems, and we've been spending years connecting them, and having a RESTful API layer over the top makes that much more simple.
Excellent. Okay. Thank you.
You bet.
Fantastic. Right? Thanks for coming here.
Thanks a lot.
Really appreciate it, Marcus. So that's how AT&T is doing it. It's just you hear Marcus talk about it. It's just changing the clock speed of how they're doing business. So to summarize, I hope this week at Connect that you'll look at the opportunity that we have ahead of us all together. There's just so much potential for us to transform our businesses. You know, think about how can you open up your apps, your data, your devices using APIs? How can you do that? What areas that maybe somebody in your organization hadn't even thought about before can you open up and unlock potential? What could you do if your business was truly a platform? What could your organization or your company achieve if you're able to really transform to being truly a platform-based company? And then finally, you know, how can you make that business composable? Because if you can get to that state, if you can get to a state of composability, it changes that clock speed of your business. How can you do that? How can you really think about going from that version 2 type of organization to a version 3 where everything just works together and you're able to bring in new technologies, change things out very quickly? I really just encourage you that we've got all the right people in the room here. There's so many smart people here that are using our technologies, people that are evaluating. There's so many partners here that have seen this in action. And I would just encourage everybody to leverage the network that's here, as Mahal was talking about, the mobile application. You know, leverage that network and talk together about how you can help make that happen. I just think there's, and you'll hear people in completely different industries that'll help you kind of think it through. So use the power of the network that we have here to do that. Okay, so next up, we have Uri Sarid, who's our CTO, and Uri is going to take us through really some the next level of detail on how to build out APIs and give us an amazing demo. All right, Uri.
Thanks so much, Chris. All right, good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. And we're going to hopefully make a little bit of fireworks happen on the stage a little bit later. But I actually wanted to start with just kind of leveraging what Greg was already saying. And hopefully you're sitting there saying, I know where I want to get to. I want to become more agile. I want my business to be more agile. I want to be more composable. I want to figure out how to turn my business into something that works a little bit faster. And I need to keep robustness. I need to keep the tires from falling off. I need to make sure that certain regulations are enforced. So it needs to be robust as well as composable and agile and fast moving. And so the question hopefully going through your mind is how? How do I actually make this happen, right? What are the steps? How do I get there? And you're gonna hear a lot about API-led connectivity. It's a simple concept, but it's actually got a lot of depth. Because when you think about it, composability requires you connecting systems and reconnecting systems and then reconnecting them again and changing them around over and over again. And because that sets the clock speed for your business, you also want to make sure that you're good at this connectivity. And we think the secret to being good at this connectivity is to concentrate on the API. To become the connectable company, you have to be an API-led company. And that's what I want to talk to you about today. So we heard a lot about APIs on the outside, right? And you know about them. You know that Google has an API, and Uber has one, and Salesforce drives most of their business through their APIs. And so when you picture the API economy, it looks like it's on the outside, right? It looks like you've got a bunch of services that you can pick from. If you want to do billing, you might choose Stripe. And if you want to do transportation, you might choose Uber. And for geolocation, you might choose Google. And all these external services you can put together and use them in various places in your business at various times and recompose them and mix and match. And that's great. But what if your company could also be that way on the inside, right? What if inside your company you were just as composable? And inside your company, you had small teams that each one offered one capability as an API, and they composed their capabilities on top of other teams, and they could choose whether to compose it on top of their own teams or on top of external APIs. And everything was that dynamic, that composable, that well-defined. And if it ends up leading to some internal competition, surely that's a good thing. You'll improve as a result of that. Now, there's a common meme that's going around microservices. It's been around for a little while now, and it's getting a lot of excitement. Microservices, despite rumors, isn't about one specific technology like Docker, although Docker is an awesome technology. And it isn't really about turning everybody in your company into a 24/7 DevOps team, although that's a terrifying and interesting thing to think about. Microservices is really about what we just said. It's picking small teams, giving them a well-defined mission saying, you own this. Run as fast and as hard and as smart with this particular thing, and then make it work together with all of the other microservices that are happening. Now, the question that you then have to ask yourself is, how do you get these hundreds and thousands of microservices and these teams to actually align and not lead into absolute anarchy? Right? That actually becomes the next goal in front of you. How do you actually make sure that you have some governance in place? And I think the answer is you look to the interfaces between them. Right? In a sense, it's just a simple matter of geometry. Right? If you've got some services and you decompose them into smaller services, into microservices, right? Here we have an illustration of these microservices that have the same volume, if you like, the same amount of code as the services that they came from, but there's a lot more APIs once you break them up. So APIs become even more important. It's just a matter of geometry. You have to really worry about how these teams and how these services talk to each other. That's where the key is. So I wanted to start with some simple scenarios that are probably familiar to you from your own business, and maybe relook at them a little bit differently than you may have before. Let's look at a very simple one where you have, say, a sales system where you take your orders, and then there's a licensing system that every time an order comes in, you need to award a license to that person. You would usually build an integration between them and make one thing trigger another. That works great. You can talk to all sorts of legacy systems if you need to, if you have an older sales system or a new one in the cloud and an older licensing system, and that works great. But what if you thought about things a little bit differently? What if you actually thought about the sales system, not in terms of how it's implemented, but think about the API that you wanted to expose, right? How would you like your sales system to actually look from a system perspective? And similarly for your licensing system, the code in there may be some fugly thing that somebody wrote a long time ago, but could you model it as an API that you have some control over, right? That you can, and again, you don't have to re-implement the system, you just have to model it as an API. And once you're in control of these APIs, then you should be able to create processes on top of them. So, for example, an order closing process takes these better APIs for sales and licensing and puts them together in a process that you control and exposes that itself as an API. And similarly, license awarding processes, right, your business processes themselves become exposed as APIs. So you're in control of the process, and it's now open to who calls that process, who actually invokes it. Which means that on top of that, you can start building all sorts of interesting experiences and channels. Right? So you can have other people partner with you to help you close sales. And you can have other channels that require awarding licenses. Maybe you have a university program and you want to offer them your software. But by building it in this way, you're not worried that everybody who creates a new experience has to redefine the process of awarding licenses. The processes are already there. You're letting other people leverage that same capability. That's the power of this approach. Let's look at another example. Very often through mergers and acquisitions, you'll end up with multiple HR systems. And the classic approach to this is, let's put a facade in front of this that makes the two systems look like you had a single system and takes care of all the nastiness underneath it. Okay, so that's a perfectly reasonable approach, but again, I think it can be rethought a little bit cleaner and something you can leverage more in the future. So look at these same HR systems and step back and say, what are the fundamental things you're dealing with? You're dealing with employees, you're dealing with payroll, you're dealing with benefits. These are somewhat separate concerns. Why don't you actually have APIs for each one of them? And map them to these HR systems and let all of that legacy stuff happen underneath that. But on top of it, it's a very clean model. And there's a team that owns employees and a team that owns payroll and so on. And once you've got the substrate laid out that way, again, without re-implementing the systems, but just putting APIs on top of them, now you can start building some interesting processes. How do we want our onboarding experience to actually be? What would we like to make sure that happens when you offboard an employee to make sure they don't have access to systems they should no longer have access to, right? When there's a life change event or when you want to enroll in some particular thing, how should that actually work? Now you can start thinking your processes without having to deal with all of the systems that live underneath that. And that means that your governance people, the HR people, are going to be pretty happy that they're in control of the process, but the employees that are on the receiving end of this hopefully are thrilled because you've put the human back in human resources. It's actually enjoyable and rewarding and something that you can actually be proud of. Again, without re-implementing any of these systems. Now, you may have to write some custom logic. We see some custom logic there on the top right. You know, separate out that custom logic from the connectivity, put in smart logic at wherever it belongs, but make sure that the connectivity remains very agile, very recomposable. Let's look at a third example, and then we'll kind of draw the conclusion from that. So at my previous company, we needed to onboard a lot of content from a variety of content suppliers, some of which were very old, some of which were very modern. They all dropped their stuff in an FTP site, and an integration was there, an ingestion pipeline, to take that content, sort it through the catalog, convert it into a variety of new formats, and eventually put it in some cloud repository where our mobile applications could access that. And that worked well. But I think there's a better way to leverage systems like this that lets you go a lot faster. Again, look at all of these systems and ask yourself, what are the fundamental objects they're trying to deal with, right? You're going to have to deal with files, right? You shouldn't be tied down to an FTP system. You're going to have to deal with content metadata, but you may have multiple catalogs. We certainly did, right? And certain things have to happen on schedule, and certain things have to have entitlements or licenses awarded to them. Think about those as individual APIs. You don't have to rewrite the systems underneath. You may have to put some logic in order to make these work that way. But the end result of that is that you can start building out processes that are very clean and very flexible. This is how we actually ingest content, right? This is how we distribute content. This is how we syndicate the fact that we have content and other people can help us sell, because now you can start rolling out all sorts of interesting experiences around that, right? You can now have other people start to supply content to you through a variety of mechanisms that you can adapt on the fly. And you can start leveraging new digital channels to take that content and find new revenue streams for it and do more social media integration, even integrate with your in-store experience without having to reinvent the processes underneath, without having to touch all those older systems underneath. As Greg was saying, to tap into all those capabilities you had before, but not burden everybody who's trying to compose rapidly on top of them with all of that legacy. Okay, so the key here actually is illustrated by this newfangled API-led connectivity self-serve machine. It's not about one team learning how to do this. It's about enabling every team in your company to be able to do this kind of thing, right? It's very much a self-serve model, right? So for example, we've got some of our customers, right, who have teams that are looking at code that literally runs on mainframe and exposing them as microservices so the rest of the company can benefit from them. We've got people who have ancient applications that are entirely written in database stored procedures. Can you just imagine, right? Just reams of PL/SQL going everywhere. But you don't have to be locked down in that, because the team that understands that can expose that all as APIs, and then the rest of the company can leverage it, right? We have logistics vendors who have all sorts of old and new partners and are wondering, are APIs for me? The answer is absolutely yes, because APIs is what allows them to reach out to their old vendors and their new partners and make it all work together, because the APIs have defined how these things work together. And probably more than 50% of interactions between systems inside of an enterprise is actually asynchronous. But APIs belong there too. You need a contract in order to be able to tell you who is producing information and who is consuming information, so you can recouple and recompose all of those things. So it's very much a self-serve model. In order to make this model as efficient as possible, you want to give people the tools to operate it very efficiently. And one of the most important tools is to be able to start from your desired goal and work backwards. And so an API design lifecycle is warranted. And it starts literally with designing that API, asking yourself, what do I want my API to be like? Not what systems I have, what would I like it to look like? And if that's you're using a very efficient tool and the AnyPoint platform gives you that capability, then you can, with a single click of a button, actually mock that API. So this thing that you just conceived is immediately live, and you can start playing with it and seeing if it actually works for you. And automatically out of that comes documentation and comes an interactive console, and you can start making API hits and saying, is this actually going to work for me? But beyond making individual API hits, you can now start to compose entire stories with your API. There's something called the API notebook that allows you to start hitting these, remember, mocked APIs. They don't exist yet. And start to say, well, if I make a call to Uber here, and then I hit that database over here, and then I hit my user system, is this actually all going to come together? How is it actually going to work? You can visualize it. You can actually test it out. And you go through this cycle a few times. We were going through it till 2 a.m. last night, actually. And in the end, you nail down an API specification. And you take that specification, and that becomes your contract, your blueprint for moving forward. Because with that API specification, you've already built all of the documentation. You've already built, actually, all the tools to allow people to build on top of the API, even without having published or created that API. And so on one side, you can start giving that mocked API to your mobile developers to go and build their applications on top of that. And in parallel, you can give your back-end developers the capabilities to start from that API and work backwards and figure out how to plug it into all the systems it needs to plug into underneath that. And they can do that whether they're using AnyPoint. They can do the same thing if they're writing custom code, wherever that makes sense. But you know that in the end, these two systems, when they meet, will work together because you've defined the interface between them. Now, what you've seen here over and over again is a fundamental building block. Right? The fundamental building block of this thing has three pieces. It has managed API capabilities in front. So you know that whenever you deploy an API, it'll be governed, it'll be under control, you'll know what it is that you're serving. It's got all the logic in the middle to connect things together, and it's got the connectivity on the bottom to reach out to other systems and pull them in. And there's different ways in which you might want to deploy this. You might want to attach some custom code on the side in case you want to have a lot of business logic inside of that. Or you might have an application that already exposes an API, and you want to put an API gateway in front of it to at least benefit from the management of those APIs. But a lot of the magic of this happens because you give this out to every development team in your organization, and all of these things know how to talk back to a core set of platform services, which means that as you're building out these APIs, the design is automatically controlled, and documentation is automatically published for all the developers. And analytics are automatically built in. You don't have to go back and retrofit everything to suck in analytics, which, by the way, hardly ever happens. Nobody has time to go back and put in analytics later. Analytics have to be built into the platform right there. Runtime management, right? All sorts of concerns that developers don't want to have to worry about are built into this platform automatically on top of a bunch of shared services. So with this building block, you end up laying out a pattern architecture. It's not a reference architecture in the sense that you have to build all these pieces. It's a pattern for how you should think about these systems. And the pattern looks a little bit like this. Now, first, I have to introduce that little guy. The idea here is what we call carrot-based governance. So instead of saying you have to build things in this way, the idea here is make it easier to build things the right way. Make sure that every one of your building blocks actually comes with built-in sort of happy type of governance, the kind of governance that you're actually happy to deal with because you didn't have to worry about all of these concerns. So with that in place, the end result looks something like this. You look at all the systems that you need to connect to and make sure that they actually have APIs on top of them. These are called system APIs. They're your systems of record. They're the things that actually make things happen. And then on top of that, now you can separate out the business processes that you want to do and design them the way that you want to happen and expose those as well as process APIs. And the third layer on top here is a little bit newer to enterprises. Ross will talk a little bit more about that. It's the experience APIs. It's the ones that are created to support very specific experiences that you can build right on top of these. And there may be lots of these, and they may be very short-lived because they only support a single experience. But remember that the governance is also happening at lower levels, right? New experience APIs won't disrupt your process because they're built on top of these reusable process APIs. Now, that's kind of the pattern architecture that you should be thinking about. Now, this tiered architecture is really important, but it's the opposite of a big monolith. And in fact, in general, transformations that are sort of boil the ocean kind of transformations, change everything, don't always work. It's actually much better to start at the bottom and make this more of a self-serve and distributed model. So the key is that you want to start this revolution from the ground up, right? You want to start by sowing the seeds, giving people these tools, showing them some successes, and when there is some success, you nurture it. You kind of showcase it. You bring this to the front. You say, this is how it works. Why don't you try this as well? And in the end, you get APIs on top of APIs. So as people do this more and more, you start to see all the power of the system because you're starting to compose and recompose your system. All right. And with that, it's time to actually demo this. So as we're setting up a little bit the demo here, I wanted to introduce it. This demo came out of pain. I took a business trip earlier this year to New Zealand. And when I arrived, I've never been there before. It was a pretty painful experience because our flight was a little bit late and ended up arriving very early in the morning. The hotel room wasn't quite set up. I didn't know how I was supposed to get there. I had to deal with all sorts of changes at that time. And I said, you know, maybe I should actually take this experience and build out the kind of hospitality business that I would have loved to have seen when I was down there and lean a little bit forward into the future. So I want to actually show you what was built in the last few weeks and to some extent in the last few days to show you what you can build by composing and recomposing all of these pieces together. So I'm going to actually go over to my laptop here and reconnect and show you my application. Can we switch over to the laptop? OK. So I'm actually going to run through this application right now. And what this thing is actually going to do is it starts with a mobile application. And this mobile application is very ugly, but it makes up for it by being very nosy. So it asks me a lot of information about myself. It really wants to know a lot about me. And this is part of this fictitious company called Hospitality NG, Hospitality Next Generation, that takes hospitality to a completely new level. So you see that it's asking me for my phone number, my email address, but it also knows about how I plan trips. It knows about my Google Calendar meetings. It knows about my music preferences. It knows how I travel around. It's got all of this good stuff. And it needs to know what I look like. So I'm going to have to take a picture here. Go ahead and take a picture. Here I am. Excellent. We're going to use that photo. Now, it's got all of these pieces, and now it's going to start doing interesting things with them. As soon as it knows about me, it starts to track a little bit my travels. And as I near the airport, I realize that maybe I'm not actually going to be on time because the plane might be delayed and so on. So what can happen is, and I'm going to start off this process by having it run in the background, you're going to see a little bit of back-end logs, right? Because you're not supposed to see this stuff. This is all supposed to happen in the background. So it's OK that it's happening sort of at the machine level. But what it's going to do is it's going to mine together all this information that I have. My Google Meetings, it's going to mine together my TripIt trip statistics. It's going to put together flight status information. Hopefully all of this will start in a moment. We shall see. There we go. Great. So it pulled in all of that information. And it's doing this all the time. And it's figuring out, wait, am I going to be late? What's going to happen here? Look at that. I just got some texts. This is great. So it's telling me, basically, the meeting is going to start at a certain time. But I'm going to actually get there a little bit later. And it figured out all the driving times. And it figured out that that I'm actually not going to be able to make it directly to my meeting. So it'll reschedule my meeting. And it will order an Uber driver. In fact, it's already ordered an Uber driver for me. I think I saw the Uber application there go. Let's see if we can see the Uber application happening. Here we go. So an Uber driver is on its way, quite unaware that we're doing a demo here. But he's going to arrive somewhere. Hopefully, somebody's going to go pick him up. And all of this stuff is just streaming and happening. And you know, I don't have to think about any of this thing. I just arrive at the airport late, but somehow happy. And when I do that, I'm in for a nice surprise. So the typical thing is you get to the hotel, you're all exhausted, now you got to deal with a check-in. Well, today, I won't have to deal with that check-in, hopefully.
Looks like I'm on.
Because I've got a different greeter here. Completely different experience. I don't have to check in, they check me in. And they don't even
Greetings.
Need people to do this.
Welcome to our hotel.
All right, so he's coming up to greet me. Very considerate of him.
I have some slippers for you.
Thank you. Very, very nice. You don't see that often.
Hello, Mr. Sareed. I recognize you from your photograph. Mm. We have room 309 ready for you.
All right.
Would you like me to show you to your room?
I would love that. That would be awesome. Let's go do that.
Great. Take my hand and I will show you there.
All right. That's how I like to be checked in. Now, it may look
silly. The weather here in San Francisco is 54 degrees and overcast. We robots work for almost nothing. I should have gone into the tech industry. Are you hiring?
Yes, we are, as a matter of fact.
You will find I have unlocked the door, turned on the lights, and started music from your Spotify playlist. Enjoy your stay.
All right. Thank you. All right, almost there. So these robots, by the way, are made by one of our customers, Aldebaran Robotics. And they're really cool because they've got APIs, and you can program them, and you can have them make outgoing weather calls, and you can integrate them with all your other systems and make them do the kind of thing that you want to do. So that's what I would like my next generation hospitality experience to be. All right. Let's give this guy a big hand. Thanks very much. Now, that's pretty cool, but I think what's really interesting is that we were able to pull this together pretty quickly, and so I wanted to actually show you how that's done. If we can go back for a moment to the slides. This is the three-tier architecture that we ended up building for this thing, right? So I just want to take you through what was actually happening behind the scenes, and then we can see all these pieces actually, how I built them. So underneath that at the bottom, here are the various systems that we're using. And you're seeing a bunch of logos that you're probably familiar with and a bunch of custom systems that we ended up writing just for this thing. And these are all the systems that we're trying to connect. On top of that is a bunch of processes that we defined in order to actually manage this hospitality experience. And at the end is the actual experience that people actually interact with. So it starts with the mobile experience that's talking down not only to a user database, but also to a notification system that remembers my cell phone, the entertainment system that's going to remember my Spotify preferences, better than me because I forgot to turn on the Spotify app here. And then at some certain time, right, and on a regular scheduled basis, it's checking all of these other systems. So it's got a travel application that's actually code, that's got all the logic, and a routing application that's really all about connectivity. And it's talking to all of these systems behind the scenes and actually figuring out, what do I need to do? And when it realizes what it needs to do, it goes and does it. So it talks to the routing system to order the Uber, and it talks to guest services to schedule a greeting for me, and it talks to the room reservation system built on top of an old legacy room reservation system, but now exposed as API so you can tell which room is available and tell someone to go and clean it up and make it ready for the person when you know that they're going to be arriving. And then a little bit later, when the guest actually arrives, guest services says, hey, go and schedule a robot to come out and greet them. And that robot will go off and make its calls and say to the entertainment system, hey, please turn on the music and create a mood with the lighting and turn on, you know, unlock the door, talk to the rooming service, make sure the right guest is at the right door. All of this stuff is happening behind the scenes to make the guest experience seamless. How did I actually do this? I started with a whiteboard. So you start to think, okay, work your way from the top down, right? What's the experience you'd like to create? Then what kind of processes will you need? What are the systems that you have? Which ones do you already have? Which ones do you have to recraft and change from other places? So you have a rough idea of what it is that you want to do. And then, if we can go back, let's stay here. Then you start designing the APIs. So you think, okay, I'm gonna need something that looks roughly like this. You start to sketch them out, right? So here's a particular API. And this one is showing you the mobile application API. So this is what the mobile application will call. You say it's going to want to transmit this data. It's going to want to send back this data. You start to sketch this out. Here's another API. This one is for the entertainment system that governs all of that entertainment. And this is the kind of thing that it's likely going to want to send and the kind of thing that it will receive. So you have a good idea of what the various pieces are. You still don't know if it's all going to work together. You haven't yet composed them together. And to do that, if I can go back to my laptop, I wanted to actually show the next step that I took. And that is, once I turned mocking on all these APIs, I started to use the API notebook to weave this together. Right? So here's the onboarding of the user. Right? I'm actually making a call to the mocked up API to see what information I get back and see if that makes sense. right? So here's the mobile API calling the entertainment API, the entertainment API calling Spotify. Then we call the user's database, and it goes on, right? And as you think through these scenarios, you build this out more and more, but there's a reference document. This reference document is awesome because now I can share it with all the other developers putting this together, and they can help me actually do this kind of thing, right? And then once I had the APIs actually worked out, I went on and started to implement. So I was implementing a lot of things in Mule. Here's a particular example of a flow. And this one is actually talking to a variety of other APIs. Here's another example of a Mule flow that's talking to a database. This is the one for the rooming database. So there's a variety of flows that you use in order to compose this thing. And the business logic was actually implemented in Node.js. So if you have your APIs defined in RAML, which is what we use, you can go back and find some community projects or our own projects that allow you to start from that API and build it in your language of choice. So all the tools are set up for you in order to make that composition really, really easy. And then, of course, you have to also deploy these applications. So I went ahead and deployed them to our cloud. You see which tab that's on. Here it is. And when I sign in, you can see that all of these services are actually running right now on Cloud Hub. And so I know that somebody else is taking care of all the management of these services. They're all green, which is great. You can see a bunch of calls were made to them recently. And that's how all of this stuff actually got pieced together. So very quickly, we were able to build something that unfortunately doesn't yet exist today, putting together pieces from the outside, putting together our own pieces, composing them together. And tomorrow, I'm sure I'm going to want to make some changes. But now it's easy for me. I have all the documentation for this. I understand how it all works. I can see all of these flows, and I can recompose them as I need. And other people will be able to reuse them as well. OK. And now I'd like to actually invite our founder, Ross Mason, up to the stage. To talk to you about how you too can actually get started doing this thing, how businesses like you are succeeding, and how you can undertake the business transformation that underpins all of this technology transformation as well. Welcome, Ross.
Thanks, Uri. That's great, thank you. Wow, hello everyone. It's great to see you all here today. What a packed room, unbelievable. Wasn't that robot awesome? It's pretty awesome, right? I love those things. Actually, it wouldn't be Connect without robots. If you were here last year, you know we had robots. We've just made them bigger this year, just like Connect itself. So that was a really good demonstration of what API connectivity can look like. My job here is to bring it into the room, bring it into your enterprise, and help you understand how you get started. Because the fact is, you're actually battling with all the things that everyone else is battling with, which is there's increasing demand from the business. The change that Greg spoke about is putting a lot of pressure on the IT organization and a lot of pressure on the IT functions across the organization. And it's driven by the increased need to bring in those cloud applications, the increasing needs for mobile applications to drive better customer experiences. And the business is just reacting to what the market needs, right? It's not that they're just making stuff up. Consumers, the experience for them has completely changed. And their expectation of what they should get from their vendors has changed as well. Everything needs to be dynamic, always on, always mobile. And as you know, you've got those dinosaurs down in the ground that Greg spoke about that are neither dynamic or mobile, right? So you've got to figure out how to bridge that gap. And if that wasn't enough, your customers will move on if you don't address this. This is where the urgency is. You've got companies like Uber redefining what business looks like for people. And so consumers will move on if you don't address these core concerns and give them the experiences they need. Now, think about banking. 10 years ago, banking was all about trust, and you stuck with your banking provider. 10 years ago, I wouldn't have switched my bank very easily. Now I can do it in a matter of minutes. I think my bank might be here. I'm not going to switch, by the way, but I could switch. And that's the reality, is that you're competing with new competition who are figuring out ways to drive new experiences and give consumers better value from these digital experiences. And if that wasn't enough, the barrier of entry for most markets has evaporated. This is exactly what Greg was talking about. That composable mode of operation is normal for startups. It's very abnormal right now for most enterprises. And that's why you need to change. That's the competitive landscape that you're dealing with. And I think you realize you need to change. I think intuitively, everyone in this room is probably here, partly because they know they need to change, and they're looking to figure out ways of how to do that. And one of the big changes is IT is no longer just about keeping the lights on and keeping the network running. The role of IT is to be an enabler to the business. It's to create a platform for the business so they can create value for their consumers. That's a different way of thinking about what most of you do today. And my job here is to help you understand how that actually happens. How do you actually shift that mindset from project-to-project delivery inside your organization to opening up the value of your organization? And we believe you can do that with API-led connectivity. And my session here now will actually talk a bit about how some of our customers are doing that and how you can get started too. Okay, so, you know, everything will be digital, everything will connect. And as I said, API connectivity is really our approach to doing this. But what you're dealing with is most enterprises, and probably everyone in this room, has all their assets locked up in those dinosaur systems, those mainframes, those legacy systems, those databases, big data stores. In and of itself, that's very hard to connect. But it's been made even more difficult to connect with the advent of cloud introduced into your organization. The business is lured by purpose-built applications that help them do their jobs more efficiently. And the role of IT and integration yesterday was just how do I get these connected? How do I move information between these different systems to better run my business? But the new role of connectivity is actually how do you take that value, those assets that's buried inside your enterprise, and surface it to the front of the business? How do you connect those assets to your audiences, your customers, your partners, your employees? That's what the role is here, and that's the changing role of IT. It's no longer about just connecting back office systems. You need to find ways to unlock the value of your organization and allow the business to actually take part in creating the new digital experiences that they so desperately want from you to drive to their customers. So SaaS, in our minds, is really another asset. It's another source of information that should be built into your IT landscape. And the way you connect to those customers, partners, and employees is through applications. So that's web applications and increasingly mobile applications, and of course, even IoT, driving new experiences for consumers with devices that are connected. And the type of things our customers are doing, they're engaging customers with new mobile applications. They're collaborating with partners through new channels, typically through APIs. And they're accelerating employee productivity with things like microapps and integrating Salesforce tightly into their IT ecosystem so that employees can be more productive. But the other thing that's changed in the enterprise is the number of applications. And I think everyone's probably feeling this too. You know, 5 years ago, there wasn't as many applications, and there's probably even up to 10x the applications today, just because SaaS brings a whole new set of applications into the enterprise. Mobile and your employees bringing new applications into the workplace through their mobile apps means that the number of applications has exploded that you have to think about. So no longer can IT just try and own the applications. That's not really reality anymore. What IT needs to do is actually own and govern the data that powers those applications. So it's a different way of thinking. Rather than owning every piece of the application stack, how do you unlock the value of that data so that other people in the organization can build those applications? And that's really what's happening, right? So if you look at who can actually build apps in the enterprise today, you've got designers, you've got line of business developers, you've got mobile app developers, and they're all going to go and build new applications and new experience for consumers with or without IT. So what you need to do is think about more about governing the data and providing self-serve access to that data. And to do that, you need to be composable. And this is exactly what Greg was talking about, right? You need to be able to allow people to self-serve, grab pieces of information, bits of functionality that they need to build these new experiences. I'm going to explain this with an analogy of a bicycle. So IT, your IT today is like a reliable bicycle. It's a bit long in the tooth, but it gets you from A to B, and it's not broken. It actually works. But the business, they're trying to create different experiences for their consumers, and they want to experiment here. They want to evolve how they use the assets inside the organization. So delivering one thing to them no longer works. What you need is this. You need to have the component pieces of your environment as composable APIs, composable services that you can pull together in different ways, experiment, evolve, and drive a different type of outcome for your customers. And the way we propose doing this is with API-led connectivity. So we're back to the enterprise slide with the assets and the audiences. And the way we position API-led connectivity, it's an approach. So many of architects in the room probably have seen lots of three-layered diagrams from every other vendor on the planet ever, right? So this isn't another architecture. I'll just clarify that. What it is, it's a way of thinking about capabilities inside your organization and who should own those capabilities. So it's a different way of thinking about the problem. And the ownership and accessibility shifts because what you're actually trying to do, you're trying to unlock the value of organization and decentralize access and decentralize value creation inside the organization, right? So that's the reason why you want to go down this composable approach. And at the bottom layer, as Uri mentioned, you have the system layer. The system layer is responsible for opening up the data, for delivering core raw data assets to the rest of the organization in a way that's repeatable, discoverable, self-serve, so that IT can get out of the way of actually running a project every time you need to get a data feed from somewhere. So that's the goal of this layer. The second layer is all about reusability of processes. So modeling processes that exist inside your organization and making them reusable. Back in the day, BPM might have been used to do this. The problem with BPM, of course, was you didn't get any reusability out of the work you put into it. To, you know, Uri's examples around employee onboarding, what you really want is a service that shows how you onboard an employee and make that reusable at this layer. The other key thing about this layer is some of the services will be owned by central IT, but some will be owned by the lines of business because they understand the applications in their domain. So it makes sense that it actually own the services that orchestrate between those systems. So, and what that means for IT is that you're taking some of the pressure off IT to deliver everything and allowing the line of business IT to own some of that, the responsibility of opening up that data and delivering it to the organization. And then finally, there's this new layer inside the organization that's rapidly emerging, which is the experience layer. And the experience layer is all about defining a customer experience, what you want the customers to experience through the mobile app or through the web application, and building an interface that reflects that, not reflecting what you have inside your enterprise. And this is very powerful because it drives a fundamentally different type of application development experience inside your organization. And the role of the experience API is to orchestrate between process APIs, system APIs, and external to bring together that data into well-defined discrete operations, much like Uri's demonstration. I mean, Uri's demonstration had 26 systems connected, but there's probably only 4 or 5 APIs that the robots and the phone actually integrated with. That was the experience at the top. And think about this, right? So if you're a JavaScript developer, 22, out of college, she joins your company. If she has to understand all the complexity of all the back-end systems inside your organization, she's never going to build that rich developer experience. In fact, you're going to have a hard time holding that talent in your organization. So the whole point of these layers is to release tension to allow other areas of the organization to be successful and self-serve and drive new value creation. And that's really what the API economy is about, is taking what's there existing and building new value on top of it. And the macro economy is the API economy. You want to build a micro API economy inside your organization. So I want to talk about a customer who's actually been pretty successful going down this route. And Wawa, if anyone from the Southeast or know Wawa, they have a pretty keen following down there. They started life actually in 1806 as an iron foundry. And then in 1906, they turned themselves into a dairy producer, which is random. And then I don't know how you fit those two together. And then they decided that they should become a food mart in the 60s. And they added gas stations on top. But what makes them very interesting, they're kings of transformation. As the market changed around them, they were very quick to rotate and change their value proposition to what people wanted. And what they're going through now, right now, is delivering a digital experience for their very loyal customers. And they started out 18 months ago looking at the Starbucks loyalty app. Many, many retailers are looking at the app thinking, we want that type of experience. Wawa did the same thing. And they actually ended up building a very comprehensive app that brings in loyalty. So customers can actually get points. They can register purchases, things like that. Very quickly, they realized they could actually pull in payments. They could pull in nutritional information. They could actually pull in gas price optimization into the same application. And they realized very early on that actually what their mobile app was not an app at all, but it's actually a new digital channel for reaching their customers in a fundamentally different way, a more engaging way. And their challenges for API connectivity were pretty huge. And I don't think people understand how big some of these challenges are. But to build this application over the last 18 months, they connected 81 endpoints. 81 endpoints. I remember working in banks 15 years ago when we connected 7 systems over the space of 3 years, right? It's completely changed the problem domain. You cannot use the legacy technology to do this kind of stuff. They actually adopted 54 new technologies to make this application happen. Think about that. The cycle for adopting technology has accelerated to a point where you could be adopting new technologies every week. And some cycle in, some cycle out. You have to have a layer of abstraction, an agility layer to allow you to do that. Of course, behind every feature was an API. Everything they deliver to the mobile app is actually API enabled by default because that's the way mobiles talk to back-end systems. And it's hybrid. So they're connecting on-premise, they're connecting their legacy stuff, maybe stuff from 1806 even, I don't know. And they're connecting stuff in the cloud, and they're connecting third-party systems. And the other key thing is productivity. And this is one area where our customers, I think, all agree on, is they're looking for more and more productivity to do things fast and do things the right way. And that's why they selected the AnyPoint platform. And the AnyPoint platform is truly unique for a number of reasons. So first of all, as I mentioned, it's the only hybrid platform out there. So and by hybrid, what I mean is you can run it in your data center, you can run it in the cloud, and it's the same tool suite, the same management suite across both. It's not different tool sets. It's not different concepts. You can actually move the integrations around depending on the needs of your organization. That's exactly what you need in this type of hybrid environment. IT is now hybrid. Another thing that makes it truly unique is unified connectivity. What we've done with the platform is actually fold in a lot of the old legacy concepts around application integration, around web services, around API creation and publishing, around connecting to legacy systems and SaaS systems, and you can now connect all of that on one platform. That's really powerful because what that gives you is a single platform on which to build this type of strategy. And to, Uri's diagram, it shows that you need one platform. If you're doing that with lots of different technologies, you're going to have a very complicated landscape. So we bucket these capabilities into 3 areas. One is sort of on-premise, sort of SOA type of scenarios where we provide capabilities for microservices, for legacy modernization and web services. That's still core to our bread and butter as us at MuleSoft. We haven't forgotten about the on-premise and the legacy. We know you need to connect that. But we've also invested very heavily into SaaS. SaaS is actually a little bit different. Because SaaS applications don't live inside your enterprise. You don't own those apps. And the lifecycle of those apps change, and they're across a different network that you don't own either. So managing those connections requires a bit more effort. And we've built a lot of that into the platform, so you don't need to think about that. So, and of course, SaaS applications are more numerous. So data synchronization is important, process orchestration, and even batch loading. You can do all these things on this one platform. And really, for me, the icing on the cake and the icing on the cake for API-led connectivity is the API platform itself. And over the next 2 days, you'll be hearing more about this platform and what it can do. But our customers are using it primarily to drive mobile initiatives. They're using it for unlocking that value internally so they can drive more value and more innovation from the inside out. But increasingly, we're seeing more APIs for B2B type of activity, such as the story from AT&T, and we're seeing more enablement for IoT as well. IoT and API seem to go hand in hand. And the building block of this platform is the Mule core runtime. So if you're a longtime user of Mule, you'll recognize this. Nothing's changed at the core fundamentals of the platform. You've got this very reliable building block that allows you to do orchestration, policy management, caching, and transformation. And it's combined with ubiquitous connectivity. We've spent a lot of time productizing connections to all sorts of stuff, from legacy systems to cloud to devices to protocols. And if we don't have a connector in one of our 130 package connectors, then you can build your own very easily. We have something called DevKit that allows you to do that. That's turning out to be a secret weapon for us because, of course, every enterprise is made up of all sorts of custom applications. And then finally, putting productized APIs on top of that means that you actually leverage the data that's being freed up and unlocked underneath through these APIs. It means that other people can come in, discover the API, and leverage that same connection. That's what leverage here is all about. You're actually unlocking the asset and giving it to new audiences so they can build value. And of course, as Uri said, we understand that customers already have a lot of investment in existing technology and existing services and code. And with this platform, it can just layer on top of the things you have already and provide a single management layer so that you can understand how information is running through your system. So whether that's web services or Node, as the example that Uri gave, or .NET, they can all plug in underneath, and we can actually manage that environment as a single autonomous plane of glass. And think about that. If you have these these layers of APIs inside your organization, and you've got MuleSoft running either as the connectivity tissue or as the gateway to provide a single point of management and governance and visibility, you get this unparalleled view of your enterprise. You can now see exactly what's going on at every point, from the point when a request comes in through a mobile app all the way down into that mainframe system that nobody wants to touch. That's unparalleled visibility. I don't know many organizations that actually have that today. But these layers, what they do is they release tension in the organization. So again, the system API layer is all about unlocking assets and decentralizing access. If you start here, you start making that data available to you. So the next time somebody asks you for reporting information or catalog information, do it with an API mindset. Open up an API and give the API to them. Don't give them direct access to the database. That causes you tons of problems you already know. The second layer is actually all about driving agility and new value creation. What you're actually saying is to the business, go ahead, use the data. You have access to it. We govern it. We'll make sure that you don't do the right things with the data, but you can go and self-serve. You can go and build new value on top of the data that we have in the data center in our applications. And at the top level, it's all about innovation. It's about driving new types of application experiences that obviously gives you happy customers. So I want to talk about one company that is on this journey already, and they have a great story. And rather than me tell you about it, I'm going to introduce Nick Stoke, who's the VP of Innovation and Platform Payment Strategy for Wells Fargo. Hi, Nick.
Hey, good morning, Rob.
How are you doing?
Good, thank you.
Excellent.
Innovate.
So, Nick, tell us a bit about what the Mobile Solution Initiative is for Wells Fargo.
Oh, thanks. Our Wholesale Mobile Solutions Initiative is all about innovating with our customers. And it was learning and listening with them about other services they want that we do alongside just your traditional banking services.
Okay. And then, how did you get started? How did you get the bank to buy into this approach of offering these services to your retail customers?
Well, these are our wholesale customers.
Yep.
And they have their own users and their customers, and we've had long-term relationships for quite some time with some very dear customers who want to innovate as well, and they want to innovate with us. We want to innovate with them as far as bringing to them things you traditionally think about as a wholesale or a bank that takes care of large corporates and treasuries. But they came to us with the chance, they need to go mobile as well. And they want to get to their end users and their customers. And as we listen to these customers, and we talk about how to help them go mobile and exposing our API services and giving SDKs to their developers, that's how it came about. And that includes things like location services, reservations, scheduling, in addition to your more traditional payments.
So yeah, tell me a bit more about the location services, because location is not something a service you'd expect from banking. So I know you've got this Beacon initiative. So tell us a bit more about how that fits in.
Well, our customers in different verticals and niches have all about how do they engage their customers and their end users, where they're at, when they're coming into their physical locations, and how to make them more of an engaged presence and reward their loyalty and respect their loyalty about what they want to do and give them a more opportunity. So in an API platform and an SDK kit that we give their developers, some of those things like location services will take that data in. And if those customers have implemented a beacon solution, that'll support them doing that.
Fantastic. And how did you come about to MuleSoft and API connectivity as the right approach for this? What got you there?
Well, API connectivity was clear as a need. We're very mobile. The bank has been innovating for many years. And with our CEO portal and then CEO mobile and now API as a coming need for our customers to reach out to their users. So why MuleSoft? We have a great set of team at Wells Fargo. We have many different lines of businesses, and I'm fortunate enough to be in the innovation R&D group. So we're a small group in wholesale, and for our needs to get there quickly and the relationship we've had in the past, it served our needs and it allowed us to ramp up quickly. And it was good for our R&D, and it helps us then bridge to the next gap for the more traditional sides of the bank to show them what can be implemented in their existing systems.
Right. Okay. So you're almost like the trailblazer in the organization of how this can be used to drive new value.
Sometimes that's a fun part. Yeah, yeah. Certainly.
Excellent. And what are the early successes and what's the next steps for this initiative?
Well, some of our early successes are enabling really nice customers of ours to go reach their users, have their customers come in, do more business with them, do it in a very convenient way, have time when they go into their malls and their establishments to achieve the experience, and have that all happen in a very seamless way, whether it's walking into a mall and not having to stand in line for things, and the merchants and the tenants of those malls and the mall owners are some of our customers, it results in more business and a much more enjoyable experience. Some of the things that this bridges to and leads to as, you know, the things that you normally think of a bank as far as payments, it helps us accelerate our strategy that's coming about of, you know, how do we turn payments into an API and how do we help our larger customers take those things about your bank that you go to a portal for and make that into their business model and part of their reach as well, to either their back ends or their actual mobile applications at their end users as well. And that leads us to things like, in the very near future, we'll have an ACH payment API available to our customers.
Fantastic. Nick, that's a great story.
Thank you.
I love it.
Appreciate it.
Keep up the good work.
Thank you.
So, the interesting thing there for me is what Wells Fargo is really doing is getting themselves plugged into the API economy. You know, they're creating a set of platform APIs to allow retailers and app developers to leverage things like location services, which is not usual for a banking provider. Remember, they do payments, they do clearings, they do those sorts of things. Having location-based services means that they can start to engage with their customer's customer in a different way and to drive new experiences further out to that more B2B to C model. And these experiences can be different for different type of applications. So right now, I know Wells Fargo is one of the application developers, but they have other people building mobile applications for in-store experiences using their APIs, right? So it's not just about Wells Fargo owning the whole end-to-end chain. They're plugging in their value and allowing other people to build value on top of it. And of course, those same application developers will leverage other services. You know, we've heard a bit about Uber today. So it's very likely if you're driving a shopping experience, you might offer people an Uber service to take them home once they've finished shopping, for example. And Uber itself then leverages other APIs from third parties like Google Maps and like PayPal for payments. And notice here we've got Wells Fargo and PayPal in the same picture. Even though, you know, they both do payments in different ways, there's room for a lot of different types of services here. And the way you win in this economy is how good your services are and how well integrated you can make the experience between different types of functions. And I think Uber, for most people, should be the wake-up call here. You know, Greg talked about the version 3 business model being composable. I think Uber's just exploded, but not just Uber, Airbnb, Alibaba, there's a number of other ones, obviously Amazon, have also shown us that getting into this mode of being able to compose your assets in ways and quickly change and react to the market needs and really become a platform. The business becomes a platform when you can actually recompose very easily through APIs. And in 2012, Uber was a great taxi application. In the last 3 years, though, they've literally exploded. They've gone to 40 countries. They've probably expanded faster than many other companies ever have in the whole world. And what they did, interestingly, at the beginning of this year is they opened up an API. So they use APIs internally. So this goes back to that API-led connectivity internally. They decided to open their API up now to third parties. And immediately, it switched on a whole new set of channels for them. So now if I go to the United Airlines app, when I go for my boarding pass, I can also book an Uber to the airport. Amazingly, if I go to Google Maps and I do a search, one of the modes of transport now is how long it will take me to Uber there. That's unbelievable. They get billions of hits a day on those maps, and now Uber is plugged into that value chain, that click stream. And the same with OpenTable. This, in a matter of literally months, people have started sucking in the value that Uber provides into their application to create new value. And this is the way the enterprise needs to operate as well. You can't operate in silos. The IT cannot be centralized. It's got to be decentralized so you enable more people to do more with the core assets and deliver more value to your customers. And the challenge here, of course, is how do you get started? Now, API-led connectivity is all about opening up your data, allowing the business to self-serve that data, but IT retaining control and governance of that data so that you have security, so you have data quality, so you have governance. That's critically important. And like I say, it's not a three-tier architecture. It's almost like a pattern architecture that helps you think about how to organize your assets inside your organization and who should own those assets and what are the role of those assets. So you've got system, process, and experience. There are different audiences, there's different functions, and thinking that way helps you to align to an API-led connectivity strategy. And I think, how do you get started over the next 2 days is you use the next 2 days to think about what API-led connectivity would mean inside your organization. Speak to our customers, speak to our prospects, really listen to the sessions and hear about how people are driving change, how they got started. Ask the questions that no one else is asking but you need to hear about. And of course, use the MuleSoft technical and business experts in the room over the next 2 days to really get your questions answered. And my one ask for you, of course, is really think about on Monday, when you go back to the office, how will you start to change and redefine the role of IT in your organization, and how will you start to become a composable enterprise? Thank you.